optic neuritis, what to do and when to do is what we would like to know. It's defined as an inflammatory condition which is affecting the optic nerve, and usually it affects young adults and especially females between the age of 18 to 45 years of age. Morphologically, we can describe two types of appearances, that is a retrobulbar neuritis where the fundus looks normal, and the other is when there is an edema of the disc, and with hyperemia we call it papillitis. Now, what are the causes of what are the causes of optic neuritis? Now, the most important that we are dealing with is demyelinating diseases, in which multiple sclerosis is the most important, and for us neuromyelitis optica is also important in this subcontinent and other diseases. Under the infectious, we have under the infectious causes we have the viral and also certain bacterial infections, in which some of the important ones which are I've listed out there, and like syphilis and tuberculosis, especially tuberculosis is very common in our country, but we do find, I have found cases of other cat scratch disease and Lyme disease, etc. And other, and the others I have listed out some of the other causes of in which if you cannot find out if it's an MS or a typical optic neuritis, then we have to rule out all the other causes. So, optic neuritis is related to multiple sclerosis, and in about 50% of cases of optic neuritis, you will find that they are patients with MS. And the presenting, it can be the presenting feature in about 20% cases of MS. And recurrent optic neuritis is more common with MS involving the same or the fellow eye. What are the ophthalmic manifestations of MS? Optic neuritis is, as I mentioned, the presenting feature in 20%. Other than that, you can have internuclear ophthalmoplegia, cranial nerve palsies, gaze palsies, pendular nystagmus, and trigeminal neuralgia. As I said, it's predominantly affecting females in the age group of 20 to 50 years, and said to be more common in the white population. Its presentation is typically uniocular. The pain develops over a period of hours to days, and the visual loss peaks in 2 to 3 weeks. And after 2 to 3 weeks, it starts improving. And sometimes the visual loss may be very, very subtle, or it may be almost complete visual loss. And other visual functions are also affected, like color vision and color, contrast sensitivity, etc. Then you may see disc edema as in the picture over here, or you may have a normal fundus. And if you do not come across whatever features I've described, we call it as an atypical optic neuritis. And what are the features of an atypical optic neuritis is that it's a painless visual loss most of the time. It's a bilateral. There's disc edema is very severe. There could be disc hemorrhages and cotton wool spots. Progression of visual loss continues after 2 weeks. Patient fails to improve with treatment. And patients with atypical optic neuritis are at a lesser risk of having multiple sclerosis. In children, it's usually following viral infections. It's usually bilateral. And presentation is more of a papillitis. The diagnosis is basically clinical and is based on such the visual loss which and the fundus picture and the pupillary responses. Other tests are done not clearly for diagnosing optic neuritis, but it can help in follow-up and in fellow eye involvement. Field charting, if you do the field charts, the field defects can vary from central cecal scotomas to any kind of field defect. And VER shows an increased latency and a depressed amplitude, and this is important more for follow-up. other investigations as shown in the ONTT are not really required in a typical optic neuritis, but in atypical cases, in order to rule out, you must do various tests in the whatever appropriate test is necessary, you have to do it. CSF analysis, again, according to the ONTT, is not required, but it is a supportive evidence with IgG, myelin basic protein, oligoclonal banding. All this can help you to further substantiate your diagnosis of MS. And other tests can be done when you do not find any causes, like to rule out toxic optic neuropathy, and NMO antibodies especially is important to rule out neuromyelitis optica, as I will be touching on this topic a little later, and genetic analysis for LHON if you feel that has to be ruled out. Then the role of MRI is important. We are talking about MRI of the brain. This is firstly, it can rule out compressive lesions, or very often the retrobulbar neuritis may be due to some compressive lesion. Then prognostication, what this case is going to be, whether it's MS or how it's going to behave in the future, and therefore the need for interferon therapy. And the MS protocol we'll discuss a little later as to what kind of protocol is to be used. And MRI of the spine is not necessary unless there are symptoms related to the spine. Then if you see two or more lesions which are more than 3 millimeter in diameter, and particularly at least one should be periventricular or ovoid, then there's a high risk of CDMS. All patients of optic neuritis should get MRI at the outset, and it's mandatory in recurrent optic neuritis patients who want to know about long-term prognosis, and if there's any other neurological involvement, and in atypical cases. So at least 3 lesions abutting the lateral ventricles, lesions which are greater than 5 millimeter, these are all diagnostic of MS. And abnormal MRI scans are found in about 96% of cases of definite MS, 70% cases of probable MS, and about 30 to 50% of possible MS. Now, OCT is something that's coming up, and probably whatever you're seeing on MRI is only telling you about the plaques, but it's not telling you about the axonal loss. So the disability develops because of the axonal loss. So how will you predict disability? The one possible way could be by doing OCT for the retinal nerve fiber layer. And if we have seen that MS patients, even without optic neuritis, do have decrease in the RNFL thickness. And it can also show up the unaffected eye, showing decreased RNFL thickness. And it can be used for subtyping the MS also. Microperimetry is something which can help us to diagnose subclinical optic neuritis, because this gives you the central fields in a more accurate and better way to evaluate, and for follow-ups. Here is a case in which we have done when the patient had an involvement, and as he recovered, this was the picture. Treatment is standard treatment which is advocated in the ONTT is the IV methylprednisolone 1 gram daily for 3 days, followed by oral prednisolone 1 milligram per kg for 11 days. And oral standard dose is not to be used. This is very important, because high recurrence rate was seen in the first 2 years follow-up